disturb you for just a minute. I apologize. So, cafes have become really common for us as gathering spaces. People are often surprised that you can bring your coffee into the library and as well as a light snack if you want to. And so we are trying to figure out, why would you go to Starbucks and sit there when and have the potential of somebody spilling their drink on you when you could come to the library with faster wireless, we have a gigabit of bandwidth in almost all of our buildings, you can bring your coffee, and we don't expect you to buy anything while you're here. So we're actually in investigation about non-users and lapsed users. We have a writing center because we believe that people turn to libraries when they are aspiring and professional writers. Claire McMillan, who is the author of The Necklace, a new book that is just getting amazing reviews, is going to be our writer in residence for the next year. It's launching September 10th. Bridget is giving me the information. Dave Lucas, a local poet, was our writer in residence this last year. The Writer Center is closed because today we are doing a Facebook Live event for the American Library Association. We have a new book club central at our association that was launched by the actress Sarah Jessica Parker. We don't think she's going to surprise us and pop in, but the author is going to be on our Facebook Live event, and it's a national event, but we're the host. We're going this way. All Cuyahoga County Public Library branches are open 7 days a week. And Monday through Thursday, we're open till 9 o'clock at night. So Monday through Thursday, 9 to 9. Friday and Saturday, 9 to 5:30. And Sundays, 1 to 5. All year, every week, year round. We're still a book place, and we're very proud of that. Reading is our number one priority, everything from helping people learn to read, like children in our 1-2-3 read program, or adults in our adult basic education program. But we also pride ourselves in being top-notch on helping people find that next great read. As part of that messaging around reading, we have authors up the wazoo coming to the library. We have 35 authors from May till August. And these are our fall authors coming. And these are nationally known authors who come to the library free of charge to speak about their works. We'll go adult first. We are a passport acceptance location, so you can come to the library and have your picture taken and file for your passport at the library. It's been a great opportunity for us to embed a service that aligns with ours, because if you're looking for travel information or language learning materials or a book to take on vacation, we're the place you want to come. It's also actually been a moneymaker for us. Obviously, we don't want to charge for library service. Public libraries in a free and democratic society are very important. But we're always looking for ways that we can raise some funds. So like the post office, but better than the post office, you can come to the library and do the same thing, plus we'll do your picture too, and it's been a consistent contributor to our budget. We make about $50,000 a month on photos and passports. Yeah, and we've been named multiple times a top customer service location by the U.S. Passport Agency. And we'll do it 7 days a week, 4 nights a week. More than 60% of Americans say that even if they have a computer in their home, they are using library computers because of our high-speed broadband and access to knowledgeable staff that can help them. Think about it if you're not a really confident user, or even if you are, and you're working on something as important as a job application, and you hit a snag and you're home alone, that can be a disaster. So libraries are definitely a big piece of the workforce puzzle in Cuyahoga County, helping people get back to work and helping people do those online job searches, those applications, get their first email address, whatever they need. We do teach classes. We teach everything from just the basic digital literacy skills through Microsoft, all of the Microsoft Excel instruction. And in some of our locations, we're also teaching the Adobe Design Suite as well. So we have 3 full-time technology instructors on staff. I'm looking at Matt, he's nodding. I'm not wrong. 3 full-time technology instructors on staff. But all of the people who work on the public service floor are ready and very able to help people with most basic technology needs. And in fact, that's how the whole idea of becoming the county benefits navigator came to be, because we have the technology, we have the staff, and we have the people. So it made perfect sense. Libraries are not as quiet as they once were, especially when you're taking a tour around. So we've created all kinds of beautiful, quiet study space where people can come and, again, use and be in an environment that is wireless, where they can bring their coffee and where they can work. So we have people who are, you know, using the library as kind of their co-working space, or you know, for remote workers, as well as people who are just looking for that third place, that place that's neither home nor work, where they just want to be in a different environment. And we have created spaces that particularly support that. So this is a quiet study room. It actually has a fireplace in there. And this is a space where people can come and sit, but we have these little individual rooms where people can just come in and ask for space to use. So any hour that we're open, these spaces are available on a first-come, first-served basis. Bridgen, how many days a week does Ohio Means Jobs come here?
2 days.
What?
2 days.
So Ohio Means Jobs, which is kind of the unemployment office, comes to the library, and they're in about 6 libraries now, and they come on a regular schedule. And so rather than having to go downtown or to the Ohio Means Jobs office, people can come to the library and get those same services right here. And the Veterans Administration is working in some of our buildings as well. So whatever services we can begin to embed into the library, we're really excited to do that. This is one of 3 audio studios, and we will soon, right? 3 audio studios, and we will soon have a 4th in Strongsville. And we also have 1 video studio, and we'll soon have a 2nd in Strongsville. And there's multiple reasons for this. It's a great place for people to create. And we know that people use libraries as creative spaces, writing, recording, producing, and we want to encourage that. We've also taken the opportunity to teach people how to use new digital tools in our library spaces. And so people take an orientation and learn how to use GarageBand, I think.
GarageBand and
So it's fantastic. And we've had people do everything from make music, which is you know, they're trying to sell on iTunes. Dave Lucas, when he was our writer in residence, reported, had all of these local authors record reading their works. That's now part of our permanent archives. We've had fire company in Garfield Heights make training videos. We have people who meet at the recording studio and make music or make commercials together. Oral histories, all different kinds of work was going on here. When Armin Budish became our county executive, we worked on a project, and we now have three innovation centers. And these are kind of entrepreneurial innovation centers for somebody who has a great idea for a product and wants to use design tools, or maybe they want to make something that they can sell on a site like Etsy. So we have one in Parma, Mayfield, and Garfield. Garfield also has our current video studio. We thought about what else is kind of in the creative sweet spot for residents. And going with the writing center and the recording studio, we realized the place where you could create your family story or your community story, like a local history department or a small not-for-profit. And so we were very fortunate to have the Mandel family fund a memory lab for us, where people can digitize and more. So Matt's going to tell you about that.
Yeah, so folks can digitize. They can digitize photos, slides, documents. You can do VHS to DVD, audio cassettes to digital, vinyl to digital, as well as Super 8mm and 8mm film to digital as well. We take a little orientation with staff. We offer it every single week. All staff is trained at this location to assist with the basic startup. So if you bring your stuff in, we can show you how to do it and teach you the steps on how to do it. Service is absolutely free of charge. And it is the lab is open as long as the library is open. So if you've got crates of old stuff or you know family members that do and they want to preserve those because they do degrade, you'd certainly, you know, we've got the technology to do it. The Adobe Creative Suite is available in there as well. So if you're looking to edit photos, colorize photos, or any of those items that you have, that entire Adobe Creative Cloud is available free of charge as well. So.
Now, we'll go to the new stage. So this is our teen area, and we tried to create a really welcoming environment. Actually, that is teen art up there that was produced this summer, Bridget?
Yes.
Yeah.
Summer.
Right. So during the school year, we have an after-school homework center for youth grades K through 8, and we also do an arts experience one day a week, Fridays. And we are very fortunate, through a partnership with the food bank, we feed lunch at, we feed lunch at 11 locations during the summer. We feed an after-school snack at 3 locations, but then we feed a brown bag dinner at 7 other locations every day after school. In the summer, when we don't have homework center or other kinds of more traditional school-related activities after school, we do what we call Camp Cuyahoga, and we run over 75 arts and technology programs throughout Cuyahoga County in the libraries free of charge. So, and so we're in the teen area, quiet today, so. School started today. So after school, it'll be crazy fast. And then this is our youth space for younger children. In all of our youth spaces, we wanted to have a kind of interactive family space. So we worked with children's museum fabricators. This one comes from a book called Journey, which Bridget brought with her. And it's a wordless picture book.
I always like to show this one because you can see the doorway.
Right. And if you're very quiet, it makes little woodland sounds, and kids love to.
You can hear the birds.
Kids love to go in there. There is a big people door
as
well.
Yeah, on the other
side. And so there's all kinds of interactives that children can use in this space. And we believe that learning begins with play, and Cuyahoga County Public Library has the largest public circulating toy library in the United States. We have 6,000 toys that you can borrow, like a book or a DVD. But we thought that we wanted to have real family play spaces, because play is so important for language development, and we could also surround families with books. So this is, they're all beautiful. This one may be particularly beautiful. Aaron Beckel is one of the most involved illustrators in the process. So now we're kind of showed you our space. And we'll go back and maybe talk in just a few more minutes.
If you want to.
Yeah. Go in there.
This is actually based on the author's illustration. So it's based on the
He
book.
Gave us permission.
Yeah,
to
so
do
they
that.
Give us permission to do it.
In orange brand, the illustration of Jerry Pinkney, in Parmesino, Baker.
He came to visit, to come see his space the first time. We were so excited for him to see it. And then he told me the story about, well, I was in town, so my mother told me to come check out where his father lived. It was just down the street in Cleveland Heights.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So it was. He went, like, he was doing school visits in the morning, and then he had a public event at night, and he came back, and he was like, I was able to see the house where my father was born. And I was like, are you kidding me? Like, I didn't know you were from here. He goes, I didn't know either. So it was really kind of a nice happenstance. But I think, you know, a lot of good people come from Ohio.
Yes, absolutely. But we actually chose author illustrators who had, you know, a kind of a theme that would tie with the theme we were trying to create. So we've been very fortunate because anybody that we have approached has actually willingly let us use their art for this purpose. So will we just go back to the room? Can we go through here? Can we go through the meeting room? Once again, demonstrating how important meeting rooms are, that we have another one. And which door?
This one. Or we can go right through the...
I'd love to answer some questions and about the library system. Yes.
This is a broad question, but first of all, congratulations. This is incredible. I don't remember the last time I've actually been to a library, and I can't believe how much it's grown. It's phenomenal, and what they can provide for the community free of charge is just remarkable. This is a topic that is fresh in my mind. Last night I went to a dinner and discussion on youth homelessness, and they were talking about how they're looking into having Cleveland area have like a center where people, where youths can go after they've either exited the foster system or about to, that can, you know, change clothes or do laundry, and then also attend GED classes and or English classes, and then, you know, get their passport or documents, things like that. And they were saying, well, where would we have this? And I was thinking, well, what about near a library? If you already have a facility that's doing all of that free of charge services, what are your thoughts on that? And what do you, has that ever come up in conversation as an idea? And if so, what are the worries about something like that as well?
So I think that I'm going to use San Francisco as an example, only because Luis Herrera, who's the director there, is a great friend, colleague. So San Francisco Public Library has been, for a long time, a real magnet for a homeless population. And rather than kind of deny it or prevent it or just, you know, try to secure the facility, they've kind of embraced it. And they have social workers on staff. So I think when libraries recognize the population and provide the right relationship staffing, it's successful. I think when libraries, you know, kind of try to use prevention as the method, it is not as successful. And I'm going to just use this as an example here. I'm incredibly proud of the fact that Cuyahoga County Public Library has no security staff. Any hour that we're open, anywhere, we are a library. You know, I came from Cleveland Public Library, which was a heavily secured facility, and you know, you can make any kind of you know, qualitative judgment about where people live and where people work, but I can tell you that we have communities, you know, inner ring suburbs with high rates of you know, crime. But we made a decision that most of the securing that was happening was around managing kids after school. And some of our branches, like this one, will probably see, maybe not today, but 100 plus kids coming through the door. Warrensville Heights, 200 plus kids coming through the door. And we bring on extra staff. We hire people who work for us part-time, and they usually work for the local school district. And the idea is that the kids are coming through the door. Let's not pretend. They have anywhere else to go. They have absolutely nowhere to go. They're hungry, so we're going to make sure that there's food, because food instability is a huge issue in our communities. And then instead of investing in security, we're going to invest in youth. So our programming after school is 100% directed to kids, to ensure that kids will have a great experience when they come to the Cuyahoga County Public Library. I hear all the time that coming into a public building without a security guard standing at the door makes a huge difference in our communities and the way people relate to us. I'm not a Pollyanna. I started my career as a jail librarian, so I get all that. But I think, you know, we've done some management things. We've really worked hard to keep our staff trained and feeling confident to deal with people who come through the door. We will bring on short-term just security when we need it. We have two security specialists on staff who will come out when there's any kind of, you know, kind of problem brewing. We also have very high standards. So people can be noisy, but they need to be respectful. So we deal with all of that, and I think, again, it's like embracing the reality and then connecting with the community can make a difference. So I would, one of the things, so now I'm going to go wear my other hat. I think we have too much infrastructure in Cuyahoga County, and we can't support it. So I understand the desire to create a unique place for people in a foster, who are coming out of the foster care system, but I think providing the services that you can't get anywhere else in a unique space makes sense. But duplicating services that other people are providing doesn't make any sense. So I think if it can be figured out as a partnership with other agencies and organizations, and if you get really involved, you know, our new Aspire Greater Cleveland program can embed in other people's programs, so we can bring the GED or the
VSOL to another site. Like, for example, VGS, the Vocational Guidance Service, we're their provider at VGS. So we can do a contract like that.
Absolutely. Thank you.
I also wanted to mention, for your own interest, that the library has a very, very large collection of digital content. So we have e-books, e-audio, e-video, magazines, music, and it's all available for free. Just get the library app, the Cuyahoga County Public Library app. You can get a library card from us online, or you can get one today before you leave, and you can start borrowing immediately from us from our digital content.
Sarah, can I add one thing?
Sure.
In addition to the digital content that we have, we also have electronic databases.
Right.
And some of those, think back to your college days, the traditional databases, like articles and things.
Right.
But other things you can access, there's one resource there that's called lynda.com. Anything that you want to learn about, from personal professional development on up to tech things like coding and Photoshop, and you name it, it's on there. Think of like an instructable online with guided examples and video, and you can access that free. And there's also like Learning Express Library, which is for any kind of test, so civil service exam, GED, SAT, you know, any of those type of standardized tests. There's scores of practice things. So, in addition to the
thanks, Matt. That's great. What else can I answer? Yes.
Do you offer any programs, or have you considered offering any programs that addresses the needs of like children with developmental disabilities, or do you have any staff members who might be trained to handle children like that when they come in for homework help?
Yeah, we do have a program. We have a partnership with the Learning Disabilities Association. And we have some particular family literacy programming that is focused on the kids, but also on helping the family to better cope with working with those children. Additionally, we have trained our children's librarians to be able to provide sensory story times for children with autism or other kind of disabilities that make it hard sometimes for them to function in the group. So we're pretty trying to be on top of that. In our intensive homework centers, we have 10 of them. So we have homework help in branches in every school district, but we have intensive homework centers in 10 locations. And these are small, we have tutors who come from area colleges who work in those more intensive homework centers, and they are able to work in small group or one-on-one with people, which also can help somebody who has a learning difference to be more successful.
And I would just add to that, because we do have one here, the majority of the kids who come and use our homework help center usually has some developmental issue, whether it's learning or, you know, ADHD. They usually need the extra help, and so we do see a lot of that when they're working one-on-one with their tutors. It's really helpful for them.
And our 1-2-3 read program is a deep collaboration with the school districts where we have it, so that when those children get one-on-one tutoring, and it's year-round to get them on grade level for reading, and the school district will usually identify if there's a learning difference so that the tutor can be better prepared to cope with that. We also have a kindergarten readiness program called Kindergarten Club. We do it in 5 locations. And this is for children who have never been in any kind of preschool program. And you might say, well, in this county we have universal preschool, why would a parent not put their child in? But if you are a single mother or father and you're trying to get to work every day and you're dragging a kid in a stroller onto a bus and your mother or your aunt says, I'll watch the kid for you, that's your first choice. So those programs also are kind of these family literacy programs that can help to talk about some issues that might arise when your child gets to school, can help families to better identify those issues before they become actually learning problems. So we're really trying to be a great partner to the whole family for learning success.
Any questions? taught in after school space. It sounds like you have absolutely amazing programming and like a wide range. Are there like a certain ratio that you're operating with staff to students like that come in? I'm just curious because it sounds like there's so many different types of programming, and so like, there's a huge fluctuation.
Yeah, it depends what we're doing. So if we're talking homework center, then we have a homework center coordinator who is a paid employee here. It's a part-time job. She, the one who works here, is actually part of the South Euclid Lyndhurst school system.
Okay.
And then we have both paid and unpaid tutors.
Okay.
Volunteer, and then like we can do federal money through the colleges, so we can be their, you know, employment.
So we tried to have like four adults maybe in the room.
Okay.
And then we would do like groups of no more than 25 at a time.
Okay.
So it's not, some of our homework centers where like we get slammed every day after school, we run them in shifts so that the room is not too overwhelmed. We also have some learning software that kids can be working on. We discovered that for the standardized tests, kids need to learn how to use keyboards, and nobody teaches that anymore. So we've bought some self-instructed software so kids can be on computers and doing other things while they might be waiting for some homework.
But then we also do say like a full-time program, and that would be, you know, we might have 20 kids and one or two instructors depending on what they're doing. So if it's like a trivia contest, there may be one person in there with them, and if it's like, you know, craft or something with more hands-on help, we might have more people in there. So it just depends what type of program we do.
Being able to add additional staff when you need it, because especially when you talk about those crafts on Fridays, I was like, how many hands do you have in there?
Yeah, it, it does depend.
Well, let me tell you,
staff.
People will say, all she ever does is talk about money. Like, it's true, because I am always out there raising money for our programs. Like, our food program is fantastic, and we are so thankful that we have such a big food bank here in Cleveland, but we've had to bring on extra staff manage food programs because the health department has very strict rules. So when we serve an after-school dinner or lunches over the summer, it costs us money out of our operating budget. And quite frankly, many of our residents who would vote for our taxes might not vote for that. So we're going to have a big fundraiser on September 8th to raise some money to cover those costs. So, all I do is talk about money. I always say, everybody else has the most brilliant ideas and is creative and talented. I'll fund the money to do that good work. So, yeah. There are seven independent library systems. We don't go out poaching to try to get people to come into our system. But I will say just two things from my personal perspective are that it would be much more cost effective to be one larger library system because we do have the lowest taxes of any of the library systems in the county, and we have not been back to the ballot since 2008. And also, I think that we have been able to do some incredibly innovative programming that takes a level of administrative structure and leadership to deliver. We also have a development office, because obviously we're raising money all the time, we're a system of a certain size. And I think we are the only library system in this county that has a real foundation. And we do have a foundation board and a Cuyahoga County Public Library Foundation that has been very successful in raising dollars for us. Yes?
I know that one of the issues in some underperforming neighborhoods is getting those people in those neighborhoods to the services that they need, so transportation issues. So do you have any kind of collaborative effort to give like the kid that really needs that homework help, that maybe has that single mom that's working two jobs here and then back home?
So many of our school districts will bus right to the library. And when we see that kids getting to the library is a problem, we work with that school district to make it happen. The 1-2-3 READ program, for example, it is a combination of raising money for school districts that can't afford to bus the kids. kids. Mm-hmm. So we've raised the dollars for school districts that voluntarily bus kids, or schools that have us to walk. Like, I mean, we don't think of Orange School District as having any kids in need, but there are plenty of kids in need, and they're actually putting in a better crosswalk this summer because they're so dependent on the walk.
Right.
You know, so yeah, we really work through that, and I think, quite frankly, in most of our needy school districts, because we're feeding dinner, this brown bag dinner, the schools have made a huge effort to get kids to the library. Kids can stay later at the library until their parents can come and get them. So there's a lot of positive things around that.
Top five favorite books.
Oh, that changes all the time. But let's see. Top author for me is Ian McEwan. So I love Atonement, and I love like everything he's ever written. I'm a huge fan of Barbara Kingsolver, if you know her work. Let's see, what have I read this summer? Oh, I just read the new Alice McDermott. I've loved everything she's ever written, and her new book is fantastic. Of course, you're putting me on the spot. I'm a mystery reader, so if you read mysteries, Tana French, she's an Irish mystery writer. She's outstanding. And our good friend, Nancy Pearl, the librarian's librarian, has just published her first novel. She's well into her 60s. I'm really excited for her. It's called George and Lizzie. I read it this summer and I loved it. But it's always changing for me because I'm a reader. I'm always reading. So.
Well, on behalf of United Way and News, I'd like to thank Sari as well as her staff. We really appreciate everything you do in the community and the ways that you collaborate. So we just give them a round of applause.